Hello and welcome to the Rosies.
Your favourite feminist panel show.
Surprise, surprise, we're all feminists.
And coming up on the show today, we have guest Ruthanne Garrett to talk about home education.
And you can tweet along with the show at the Rosies TV. If you've also got any topics, thank you, ladies. If you've got any topic ideas for the show, you can email us at latestrosies@gmail.com. We look forward to hearing from you. Also, fan mail, we love it. Ruthanne, thank you very much for coming and joining us.
Thanks for letting me be here.
Now, we're here today to discuss homeschooling, or as you just told me, home education in England.
Homeschooling is quite an American term. We normally use home education, but kind of interchangeable.
So. Okay. How did you get started in home education?
I didn't know it was legal in England. When I was 18, I went for a year to America and I au paired for a family who were home educating their kids, and I was bowled over by it. They were starting like 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning. The kids would get up and do the work that was set for them for the day, and by 9 they were finished. These children were 9 and 6, and there was a 3-year-old who was so excited to start, even though she wasn't of school age, that she was doing it as well. And I just thought, this is great. And they were doing so much with their lives during the day when I was thinking about my childhood and how I'd been in school 6 hours a day, like 5 days a week,
learning
38 weeks a year for 12 years, you know. And and I just thought, wow, there's so much more you can do. So I kind of, that's why I decided then that when I had kids, I just wanted to give them this idyllic childhood. Mm. And so there just wouldn't be time to do 12 years of that much school, because I had so many other plans for them as well. So that was my, it wasn't that I didn't like school particularly. Yeah. My sons went into secondary. So it wasn't, I'm not like an anti-school stance. It's just that it affords so much more time to do everything else that you want to do.
You have 3 children, and they've all experienced homeschooling.
Yeah. My sons are 21 and 19, Alec and Aidan, and they're both in university now. They went into secondary school, partly out of choice, partly because their dad was quite up for them doing it, and I didn't want to make a big fight about it. So so I kept saying to them, if you want to come out, let me know. You know, you've got the choice. But they were like, no, we're fine. So they did that. But I home educated them right at the beginning of primary. Mm-hmm. And my daughter's now 11, and I wanted to home educate her right from the beginning, but she was absolutely adamant that, like, 3 years old, no, me go nursery, me go school. I was like, okay. So, you know, if it's child's choice, then I kind of, you know, I let her choose. But I took her out round about year 2. Mm-hmm. Lots of different reasons, you know, one, to just give her more of the time to do all the different things, and but also that it was getting to the point where those issues of not being allowed to take her on holiday during school term times, and really not liking that she was being told she couldn't go to the toilet when she needed to go to the toilet was an issue. And so there was things that were coming up that I was going, actually, now, even if she... And she was kind of like, I don't mind if I'm school or home educated. I don't really mind. So she wasn't like adamant one way or the other. And so at that point, I kind of went...
Exercised parental.
Yeah. When I took her in the February. I was sneaky. I did the bit, you know, when they go from infants to middle.
Yeah. Mm.
I took her out in the February then, because I thought then she'll have this. She already had a place in her next, in the middle school.
Yeah.
So I thought she can go straight back into a class if she needs to. So I took her out in the February to give her all of that February through the summer to see how she liked home educating, and then she could decide. But by September, she'd made so many friends and was her timetable was so full. So
what is the home educating timetable like? Is it doing the kind of 2 hours in the morning?
There are as many different timetables as there are home educating families. So you go from, maybe some people will have tutors in and their child will start at 9 and finish at 3. There's an online school called Inter High. So some kids sit down at 9 in the morning and they've got their classmates online. Mm-hmm. And they're home educated, but they're working through that. So that really works for some families. And then at the other end of the spectrum, which is more where I've tended to be, is a much more sort of unschooling. You just learn from what you're experiencing at the time. Mm. So we maybe did, throughout her primary years, I might have sat her down to do maths maybe once a month, but she was still learning. Whenever I would secretly, you know, worried myself, I'd like go down the SATs list without showing her, going through her work and like checking it, like, I wonder if she's up to... A lot of home-educating families will say, oh, you really don't need to be doing that. But that was my nerves of wanting to make sure she was level. And she was always on par.
Yeah, so I suppose didn't worry. That's a very big concern about people who don't know about homeschooling or unschooling or aren't very sure. The idea that, you know, what level are these children going to be at? Will they meet a standard when they do then go out into the real world that is of a level of other people their age?
For us, home educating is much more about providing ample opportunities, you know, a day-by-day basis of learning and interacting with society and other children and museums and trips and business people and, you know, shops and, like, lots of... You know what I mean? There's so many learning.
Well, what do we think, girls? Would we have wanted to be home educated? Would we home educate?
When you say homeschool, I'm imagining like in the home. So you're saying there's other children there, and I'm like, well, if you're at home, aren't you by yourself? Or
Like if you're out in the Australian outback, home educating, and there's no one within 100-mile radius, you might then have this picture of the children that sit at home longingly looking out of the window. You know, I'm so lonely. But in most cities in the UK, in most areas in the UK, there are lots and lots of home educating families, and it's on the rise all the time at the moment. When my boys were little, they were less, but they still probably had maybe 30 or 40 friends. Whereas my daughter, because I knew I was coming here, I was trying to count how many friends she interacts with.
Yeah, of course.
I started listing them off, and I got to 100 and thought, okay.
Oh, good. For real?
She's good. That's she meets
so
many people.
She's got a squad. Okay. It's good.
Gymnastics.
That's more than a squad.
And, I don't know, gymnastics groups and art groups and sport groups and, you know, there's so many activities.
I think I had, like, maybe, I don't know, 5 people I liked when I was a kid.
Yeah.
There's like 100 people.
100. Oh, yeah, she doesn't like them all.
Oh.
I think not
that's
liking
That's just who
them.
She sees.
Yes, but it's ever so important for children to meet with children that they don't like.
Yeah.
It's a really part
of forced play dates.
Education.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it is. It's the same with school, isn't it? I mean, that sort of socialisation. If we only let them meet the ones they liked, I think
then the real world is going to be a bit of a shock.
Yeah.
That's true. I never thought of it that way.
Yeah,
what sort of schools did we all go to?
State school.
Yeah, mixed state school.
Yeah, I went from a mixed state school to a private all girls school. So that was a bit of a change.
Sounds like a shock to the system.
It was. I mean, there was a boys' school up the road, so it was always, you know, we'd always sort of meet up after school. Well, I say we. Like, all the cool kids would meet up with the boys after school, and I'd go home and
my mum had the same deal. My mum had the same deal in Ireland. They had a, what was it? They had a sister school of an all-boys school, and they'd all meet up on the green. And be let's go to the disco.
It was the place to be for the cool kids. Hampstead.
Popular at school because I had... two older brothers. I went to an all-girls school for my second
year,
but I had two big brothers.
You had the hookup.
All my friends are like...
And of course, everyone wants to hang out with the older brothers. Fancy. Very fancy. Well, it's now time for our word of the week, which this week is unschooling. Very helpful for this discussion. And when you join us after the break, we'll be learning a little more about home education. Unschooling, also known as student-led education. This is a teaching method in which students study those topics that interest them rather than follow a predefined curriculum. It's a method of homeschooling that puts the desire, drive, motive, and responsibility for learning in the hands of the learner. It's defined most often as a life lived on one's own terms. A fundamental premise of unschooling is that curiosity is innate and that children want to learn. From this, an argument can be made that institutionalising children in a one-size-fits-all model of schooling is an inefficient use of the children's time. Conventional schools require each child to learn specific subject matter in a particular manner, at a particular pace, at a specific time, regardless of that individual's present or future needs, interests, goals, or any pre-existing knowledge he or she might have about the topic. Unschooled students learn through play, household responsibilities, personal interest and curiosity, internships and work experience, travel, books, elective classes, family, mentors and social interaction. It's believed that the more personal learning is, the more meaningful, well understood and therefore useful it is to the child. Unschooling does not just apply to school hours, as children are supported to pursue or self-direct the myriad of things that are of interest to them, eat foods they enjoy and in quantities that are satisfying, sleep and rest according to their individual needs, choose friends of all ages or none at all, as they learn through their natural life experiences. Critics of unschooling see it as an extreme educational philosophy, with concerns that unschooled children will lack the social skills, structure and motivation of their schooled peers, whilst proponents of unschooling say exactly the opposite is true. Self-directed education in a natural environment better equips a child to handle the real world. Hello and welcome back to the Rosies. We're still joined by Ruthanne Garrett to discuss home education. Now, before the break, you mentioned, Kitty, that you went from a state school to a private girls' school.
Quite the transition.
It was quite a change. I did the other way around. I went from a private Quaker school to a state school, which was the biggest, weirdest experience of my life. Felt like quite a mistake at the time.
What's a Quaker school?
A Quaker school, yeah, sorry. A Quaker school, I just say to governors, a Quaker school is based on Quaker principles. Quakerism is a religion that's based on the idea that all people are equal, even adults and children. So we didn't necessarily sit in rows with our teacher at the front talking down at us. We might be sitting in a circle facing the centre of the room. It was very much we could have a discussion. More like in university, we don't have to put your hand up to answer a question. And if we needed to go to the toilet, we kind of just went. You left the room to go to the lavatory.
Yeah, sure.
And then returned.
Just heard the phrasing there.
There's that trust that, you know, if you respect the child and trust them, they're going to respect and trust you back.
Of course.
And then when I was in sort of comprehensive school, and I was like, I'm 16. Why am I having to put my hand up suddenly to do this? I've never had to do this. Mm. Why? Because the idea that if you say, can I go to the toilet, implies they could say no.
Yeah.
Which surely is against your human rights.
Yeah, surely you should be allowed to do what you gotta do, bodily functions and all that. It's a weird thing to rule, isn't it?
I remember, can I go to the toilet? Can you?
Yeah,
oh,
always can.
May
you.
I go to the toilet? I don't have time for this now.
You don't say that to someone who's on the edge.
Grammar.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It's not the time.
I'm sure we all remember someone in primary school who didn't make it.
Yeah, definitely.
Didn't make
it's
it.
One of, it's just one of those things of another sort of like school is there to sort of humiliate you and get you through teasing a little bit. It's just sort of like a bit of a rite of passage, like you were saying earlier, Kitty.
Yeah, that like, I mean, I guess all of us have some kind of awful school story, and I think that's kind of a universal thing as well, and it shouldn't have to be. I think, like, as well, like, school kind of assumes that everyone works in the same way and everyone interacts the same way and everyone learns the same way, when really everyone is so different.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think especially with like homeschooling as well, I think it allows for a much more of an open environment in terms of education. Like, you know, some people just can't do exams and that's just the way it is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And whereas I think homeschooling allows for people to learn in different ways, I think that's really cool.
But then can we argue that homeschool children are potentially missing out through that rite of passage that is humiliation in front of your class.
You were saying before the break that, you know, they do still meet each other a lot, so there's still fights go on. I still get my daughter coming home crying because she's friends with her and she's not friends with me, and all that sort of stuff still goes on. I just think, and I think in schools, you know, we have to say there are so many staff working in schools who really want to give children their rights and really want to be child-centered and really want to do the best. But the funding is low, the child to adult ratio is low.
Mm.
You know, so the teacher in the small independent school or independent learning centre where they've got 1 to 8 is going to look like a better teacher than the teacher in a really kind of inner city area, an area where there's high poverty, where they've got 30 kids in a class.
Yeah.
Then maybe you do start to go, well, can they 4 go to the toilet at once, or is something going to happen? Because I can't be there to make sure everything's okay. Yeah. You know, so I think the adult-to-child ratio...
But then when we are discussing things like, obviously, the biggest areas of our country that have issues with schooling would be the poorest areas. They're the ones where the schools aren't very well funded, where there's huge class numbers. But they're probably also the areas where people would find it quite hard to homeschool.
There is a growing base of people who are now home educating, kind of across, I hate to use the word class, but across all the classes. Mm. Whereas probably 20, 30 years ago, it was much more of a middle class thing. Mm. Now, as the rules get stricter and people aren't able to take their children there on holidays, and people are just becoming a bit more aware of the legality of it, that they don't have to be a teacher, that they don't have to know everything, that there's these sort of co-ops that people can get together. Mm-hmm. And with Facebook and with, you know, online, where they can connect with other people, actually more and more people are going, hang on, you know, they're like me, they live in my street and they home educate, I can do that. You know,
what about parents who have a job where they're working from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m.? How could they homeschool their children?
I work part-time, and I have a very lovely ex-husband who helps, is fortunately a taxi driver and therefore can sort of work the sort of shift he wants to. So my daughter does sort of go between us and sometimes with childcare. A lot of my friends are sort of work and will, one will have the children and then they'll pass to the other, so that, you know, you sort of do a child swap.
As parents.
Yeah, that's great.
I just think if you're, you know, if you're in the situation where maybe, you know, when children, sometimes 13, 14 is often a big time when people get really stressed. School is a lot to cope with when you're coping with puberty as well. Yeah. It's a massive
exams
thing.
Piling on top.
And there is, you know, the rise of mental health issues amongst young people, and there's still that, but you've got to get A's. It's like, no, you know what? They've got to get well.
It's unimaginable pressure.
I think when you get to that point, you'll make it work. You can find a way if you know you can.
But what sort of qualifications can a child that is home educated get? Can you get the GCSEs or A-levels?
It's hard to do the coursework. So a lot of home educated children go for IGCSEs, which are much more, again, exam-based at the end. So there's not all the coursework in IGCSEs.
What is that?
International GCSEs.
Okay.
Like if you're a kid in Germany who wants to take, maybe you're with an army family or something, and you want to take the British system, you'll take the IGCSE, and then you just do the exam. But there's a lot of, like, we do arts awards and sport leader awards as well. So, and some children go all the way through and don't do exams, and then email universities when they get to 18. Sorry, my son did a similar thing. My oldest emailed universities and said, I don't actually have any A-level equivalent UCAS points, but this is what I've been doing. I've been running a swimming group for home-educated kids. I've done this massage course. I've done physiology and anatomy. Quite like to do a degree. And 5 unis replied and said, yeah, apply.
That's really good.
5 yeses is more than I got. Yeah. We're getting my A-levels.
He didn't get 5 yeses. He got 5 say apply, and he got 2 yeses. So my other son, who got a raft of A-levels, did have much more choice.
Yeah.
But then it depends on the child. So if you've got a child who's going to try and take GCSEs and potentially fail them all and have their self-esteem knocked in the same way, then maybe actually 5 who say apply and 2 that say yes is good enough for them to be healthy and do that.
Well, thank you so much for this amazing discussion about home education. I think we've raised a lot of really good points. And I think people at home who are possibly considering, maybe you've got a child who just isn't doing well in school, we've got a lot of points today, and you should go and research it.
I'm definitely going to go and research a bit more.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
Good job on learning your voice.
I've mentioned my brother before,
as well,
who has an alternate education. Really good. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks.
Alice Walker is a feminist author and activist, perhaps most well known for her acclaimed novel The Colour Purple, which won the Pulitzer Prize and the National Book Award and was later adapted into a film of the same name. Walker was a social worker, teacher, lecturer and a significant activist during the civil rights movement in the southern states of America in the 1960s, fighting for equality for all African Americans. She used her lived experiences as a black woman in the South to inform her examinations of race relations and politics in her works. Walker is also well known in the feminist world for coining the term and social change perspective womanism, a movement which seeks to eradicate inequalities and injustice against all. She coined the term to address the lack of intersectionality in mainstream feminism, as she realised the separatist nature of feminism. The movement at the time did not take into account perspectives of black women, and in so doing made the movement separatist. If you'd like to read more about the amazing Alice, we at the Rosies recommend reading The Colour Purple, In Love and Trouble, or Revolutionary Petunias.
That was the Rosies. Thank you very much for joining us this week, and thank you to Ruthanne Garrett.
So, what do you think about home education? Give us a tweet at the Rosies TV.
Do you like it? Do you hate it? Would you do it?
Were you homeschooled? Did you hate it? Do you think it's too much on the parents, too much of a commitment? Let us know.
It's a lot of questions.
Is it possible for it to be done across class boundaries?
Oh.
Tell us, what do you think?
Fascinating subject. See you next week.